particular aspects of this huge topic.
Number one, the current international drug control regime. Number two, the role of youth in drug policy. And number three, we'll look at drug policy as a developmental issue. Now joining us today, we have an international panel of discussants who have been directly impacted by the war on drugs, have been researching drug policy related issues for over two decades, have been working on the ground with people who use drugs and have been affected by it, and those who have been involved with youth initiatives dealing with this policy area internationally. Now you all have their detailed bios in front of you, so I'm not going to go into all the detail. I'm sure many of you have already read it, but allow me to briefly introduce our panelists today. Dr. Paul Hart joins us from Columbia University, where he's Associate Professor in the Department of Psychology and Psychiatry. Among his numerous publications on the topic of behavioral effects of psychoactive drugs on humans, he's also published his memoir, and I would highly recommend you to read it, High Price, Drugs, Neuroscience, and Discovering Myself. Adeolu Ogunrombi is Project Coordinator of YouthRISE Nigeria in West, and in West African countries, which focuses on advocacy, capacity building, and research on drug policy reform. He also serves as a member of the West African Commission on Drugs, and he joins us today from Nigeria. Sophia, perhaps the youngest member of our panel, has spent the last 8 months as an outreach intern at a needle exchange program and harm reduction center called the Washington Heights Corner Project in New York City. Among other things, her responsibilities have included working with drug active users, training people in overdose prevention, and picking up syringes in the local community. And finally, Lisa Sánchez. Oh, sorry, not finally. Not finally, sorry, you have to be a turn. Angela May, who joins us from Vienna, where she's Director of Research at the United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime, the UNODC, where she oversees global, regional, and national research in areas of drug markets, drug trafficking, transnational organized crime, among other issues related to drugs and crime. And now finally, we did do well yesterday, 3-1. From Mexico City, Lisa Sánchez, who's Program Manager for Drugs Reform Policy Foundation and Mexico Unido Contra la Delincuencia. She has been directly involved with working with a number of Latin American governments on international drug policy and has published works looking at drug problems in the Americas. My name is Joel Sandhu, Program Manager from the Global Public Policy Institute in Berlin. Let me begin by saying again, thank you very much for coming far and wide and for being with us here today. Thank you. Let me begin just setting up a little bit of the ground rules. The discussion will take place in two parts. The first segment will start now until 11 a.m. At 11 a.m. we'll break for a 15-minute coffee break. We'll return for a Q&A session. During the first segment, we ask our audience to take notes of your questions. We will not be entertaining questions at this time. There will be a discussion between our panelists. When we return from the coffee break and for the Q&A section, the audience can directly engage with our panelists with questions to either one or more of the panelists. If you have mobile phones, I kindly ask you to turn them off now, and we can begin. Especially your panelists. Fantastic. Let me begin. Angela, I'll start with you. As I said, you know, given the complexity of international drug policy, I think it's important that we start off with a kind of common definitional understanding. And this may seem like the obvious, but do help us lay the landscape a little bit. What do we mean when we talk about legalization and decriminalization of drugs, and especially in the context of what we've been hearing in Uruguay, for example, and in the U.S. states of Colorado and Washington?
Okay. Roger, first of all, thank you very much and good morning to everyone. And thank you for inviting me. I'm used to attend meetings where I feel young. So I'm glad that today I actually feel old. And I'm really glad to have such a young audience and passionate, and I've seen also your biography, very knowledgeable. So I don't know, maybe it's hard for me to understand what you don't know. But okay, I will start maybe to put in perspective a question on legalization and decriminalization. And just to start you that, you know, we have been now, as I'm sure everyone of you know it, you know, every year we produce the World Drug Report. And for this year, World Drug Report, we are launching in 2 days. This one. For this World Drug Report, we thought, okay, we do the usual trend, we see how the situation and so on. But then we said, okay, we have to write something about this new policy. But what do we write? And because what we do, you know, and we are really very careful in making sure that the World Drug Report remains an evidence-based publication. It's a research publication. It's not a publication to discuss political views or so on. So we said, well, there is not much evidence. But then we said, okay, let's maybe try to discuss some of what is happening, and for example, to make some clarity on some of this terminology. Well, we discover that there is not much clarity on this terminology, on depenalization, decriminalization, and legalization. And because we noticed that, you know, we have been seeing some definition and they are not all the same. So we really try to see and what is within the convention and what is not within the convention. So let me start from what we understood. And, well, first of all, you know, as you know, the convention, what do the convention do? Basically, they state that drugs should be controlled and not it's not the prohibition, okay, regime, it's a control regime. So that, and control, what does it mean? That the drugs should be used only and for medical and scientific purposes. So basically, the convention say, we, the countries that have agreed to the convention, we all agree that drugs should not be used for recreational use because they are harmful. So that is basically, you know, in a nutshell, the convention. What the convention do not say is that drug users are the problem, that drug users should be in prison. That's not what the convention say. The convention actually say that drug users should be treated, even if those that are in prison should be, you know, treated for their condition, and for if someone is caught for the possession of drugs should actually be looking for alternative to prison or alternative to criminal justice system. So that's what the convention say. So when we talk about decriminalization, that means that from if a country, you know, had set up some penalties for the offenses related to drugs. And there are kind of two type of offenses. One is for personal use. So possession for personal use. Another type is the possession or trafficking. So the idea is to distinguish what are the possession just for drug use and the possession that is intended for selling, okay? So for possession for personal use, many countries have even in the past, kind of what we say depenalized possession for personal use. What means that they had certain penalties, okay, established by the law that could be of a different nature. Okay, where what the convention say is that the drug offenses should be criminalized. What does it mean? That they should be a criminal offense. You know, in a justice system, you have criminal offenses and administrative offenses. So it means, you know, someone is breaking the law. Okay? So depenalization means that if someone is caught for possession for personal use, the state may decide to reduce the penalties. So if initially they had set a certain type of penalties and every country set up different penalties, depenalization, it means that this penalty is reduced. Okay? And depenalization can be for all type of drug offenses and also for other type of offenses. Okay? The state at a certain point decide, well, the punishment that I have stated for that offense, now I want to reduce it. Okay? Decriminalization means that, well, we still, have a criminal offense. Okay? But again, a state may decide to say, okay, instead of giving criminal penalties, I give an administrative penalties. So I change it from the criminal justice system to the administrative system. Okay?
Let me jump in real quick because it sounds, this is very interesting. What we've heard yesterday, because you're talking very much about the structures from the legal side. At the same time, we heard yesterday about the...
Joe, you might want to speak up or give
a... Sorry. Yeah.
Thank you. But one thing we heard yesterday was that it may be an issue of structural problems rather than drugs themselves being the issue. I want to hear what you have to say, anyone.
Yeah, so you don't want us to give long lectures like we just started to have? No lectures. Nope.
I mean, there's so much to say. I'm going to be brief, just 2 minutes or so everybody else can have an opportunity. I just want to think about the framing. When you talked about George Soros' comments about the war on drugs being a failure, that's wrong. The war on drugs has been a huge success in putting money in the pockets of a lot of people, locking up people. It's been a huge success. So if you walk away here thinking that it's been a failure, we have failed you, because it has not. Things that are failures don't go on for the long amount of time that the war on drugs has gone on. It's been hugely successful at helping people stay wealthy. Another issue related to this is that people say that war on drugs is controversial. It's not controversial. It's kind of simple. What we're doing is stupid. That's not controversial. When you look at the science, you look at what drugs do. Like some people said in the conventions, for example, there's a statement about these drugs are illegal or they shouldn't be used because of their potential dangers. One of the most dangerous drugs in our society, it's nicotine, alcohol. They're used for recreational purposes because we can teach people to use them for recreational purposes, and they serve an important function in our society. So the notion that these things are bad because they're dangerous, that's ridiculous. Driving an automobile is dangerous, but we're taught how to do it safely. So you all should think about questioning the assumptions on which these laws are based, because that's where the action is located.
I would just like to add a couple of points, because I understand that this challenge is about public policy, so beyond the definitions of what is depenalization, decriminalization, or even legalization, I would like to talk about the impacts of any of these policy choices. Because the first message I would like to convey is that the war on drugs is an alternative, it's a choice, it's the wrong choice, as Carl has said, because it has had many impacts that were unintended, but that caused a lot of harm. Social harm, economic harm, human rights harms, and public health harms. What I would like to say is that depenalization and decriminalization, both are alternatives that are partial solutions to a problem that was originally created by the international drug control system, in the sense that this particular system worked for pharmaceuticals, and not even for pharmaceuticals when you actually see access to painkillers in developing countries, but it didn't work for what we know as illegal drugs. So all of these drugs that we are banned and that we're not allowed to use recreationally had like this particular policy had consequences that went beyond of these substances, that went beyond of the potential harms that they were oriented to prevent in terms of the substance, and it caused a lot of harm. I would just say, for example, Mexico, or a lot of countries in Latin America, had adopted a decriminalization policy in which possession for personal use is no longer a criminal offense, but it's penalized in a way that it's sanctioned by the state with other types of administrative sanctions and whatnot, even fees. The problem with that is that when you actually see the reality and you go to the prisons and you interview the people that are locked up in there, you see that 80% of the inmates in our prisons that were incarcerated for drug offenses, what we call offenses against health, it's called delitos contra la salud in Spanish, 80% of these people are there for possession, simple possession for personal use. So when, like, when we're talking about these definitions, you always have to think about the impacts of any policy. Because even if under the conventions, use is not necessarily criminalized, the UN has turned a blind eye to all of these countries that were signers of the conventions and allowed them to do a lot of policy choices that were wrong and that caused more harm than they prevented. So, for example, we still have many countries that have the death penalty for drug offenses. How can a system be effective? How can a system be preventing harm if you can still lock up people for simple possession and you can kill them for drug offenses?
Thank you. I actually want to turn our attention really quickly. Sophia, I want to ask you, the work that you've been doing in the current project, and you've been directly involved with people who've been affected by drug use, where would you say drug policies, especially in the US context, have worked and where they've fallen short in your experience?
In the short, I mean, I was there for 8 months, so I wasn't there for that long, but actually, just yesterday, I don't know if anybody's heard about this, but Governor Cuomo signed a bill that'll allow the distribution of naloxone, which is a life-saving drug and overdose prevention, overdose reversal drug. So yesterday he signed a bill that will allow people like myself that were working with harm reduction facilities to distribute that Narcan without a prescription, which makes it a lot easier for us to get out a lot more Narcan quicker. So that's a perfect example how, in some ways, drug policy has worked. Another example of that is the 911 Good Samaritan law, which was put into effect in 2011. Again, this is only for New York State. But basically, if you witness an overdose and you have a fear of calling 911 because you either have something on you or you're intoxicated yourself, you're actually protected by this law from being arrested unless you have any warrants out for your arrest already. But if I, let's say, for example, if I witnessed an overdose and I knew that I had heroin on me, I would not have to be afraid about calling 911 because I knew that I would not be prosecuted for any possession because I was saving somebody's life. So there are some laws that have been put into effect that do help the drug user community, definitely, but there are certainly other areas where it could be improved. And I think it's also more not only an issue of the laws that have been put into place, but also the attitudes of law enforcement. For example, if you're a participant of a syringe exchange program, you are legally allowed to carry dirty and sterile syringes on you, so syringes that have residue in them, you are allowed to legally carry. Technically, a police officer that stops you and sees and finds the syringes would not be allowed to arrest you for that if you're a participant of syringe exchange programs. But from my experience in talking to people that I work with, active drug users, they say that they still get arrested constantly for that, even though they have their proof, their identity, that they are a syringe exchange participant. They're still getting arrested and locked up just, you know, for the night or whatever, but it's still, you know, an annoyance. It's just the police officer trying to make their lives more difficult. So
could
I think...
Could you explain that? I mean, if they are legally allowed to do so, how... What kind of...
They look for other petty... Let's say if they're in a building they're not supposed to be in, they find other ways to arrest them for other smaller charges. When the real issue is, as soon as they see the syringes, they think drug user, stigma comes in, you know, they try to make their lives as miserable as possible, basically.
Good. We'll get in here a minute.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Actually want to, you know, bring in the African perspective and talking about the conventions and the laws. I would like to say that, you know, Africa has actually fought so many wars that when you check critically, most of those wars are actually unnecessary. And one of the wars we are also fighting at the moment is also the war on drugs. And most policy issues within the country and like in many other countries outside the region are reactionary in the sense that these policies came into existence in the light that, look, there's drugs and we need to do something, we need to prevent this, you know.
When you say Africa, do you mean the entire continent or east, west, what do you mean?
The entire continent, exactly. The entire continent. And, you know, it's most of the policies are reactionary in the light that, look, there's, you know, drug trafficking, there's drug issue, there's need to maintain international relations, and so we need to do something to show that, look, we're not putting our countries or the continent in bad light. So most of the policies are reactionary in nature, in the sense that, look, we don't want to be in the bad books of international countries, so we need to do something. And in order to do something is about clamping down on people who use drugs. So the war on drugs within the continent has been a war on drug users themselves. Like, looking at the conventions, oftentimes, you know, just like the explanation which had this morning, the convention itself doesn't, you know, talk about prohibition of, you know, of drugs. It doesn't talk about putting drug users in prisons, but in the actual implementation, that is actually what you see. It's the drug users that goes to jail, they are the ones that goes into detentions, and it's about clamping down on individuals, and brings, as a result, you have human rights violations, you have people being criminalized for mere possessions, and people who are traffickers, just like Carl said, people who are actually profiting from the business, working free, and also, even in government, people in power, but the street guys who uses the drug is actually the one that pays the price of being put in prison or being, you know, criminalized for mere possession and usage. And I know there's been a lot of debate around the issue, how do we, you know, draw a line between possession for personal use and possession for trafficking or dealing. And oftentimes, try to bring into the context of the African debate, oftentimes when this issue comes up, you know, you hear the law enforcement agencies, you know, agent tells you that, look, a drug user is a potential evidence to arrest a trafficker. So if you're talking about decriminalization, you're talking about allowing a drug user to be free, then you are cutting off the linkage between getting the trafficker and disorganizing the organized crime. So for the law enforcement agents, it's getting the drug user is like a tool to get into the organized crime.
Can I say something, bro?
Yeah.
So one of the things we have to say when we make this point is that in the United States and around the world, I'm sure, 80% of the people who are arrested for drugs are for simple possession, not traffickers. So that's a myth that we're going after traffickers. That's just a myth that you all should not accept.
Exactly.
I wish it was so simple. just I state that I'm not here to do advocacy. So I'm a researcher. So even if it sounds maybe
I'm a researcher too.
I would like to talk about in relation to evidence. And there are two or three things. One, I think Lisa said the right word. The issue is the impact. And when policy choices are made, we always have to look at the impact that these policy choices have. But the impact has several aspects, okay? We have evidence today, and I've seen that some of you that actually have studied public health, medicine, and so on, so you know that we now have evidence that even a drug like cannabis that has always been thought as light drug have serious health impact, particularly on the young people. I mean, I think it's indisputable that clearly there is a big health impact. And so definitely there are other impacts and there are other issues that are relating to the implementation of the conventions that we have to look at the impacts. But when we talk about human rights, I don't know those of you who have read the Charter of the Children's Rights. Well, you may look, and there is one article that says that children should be protected from the use of drugs. So there is always, a balance.
here, let me do it. I gotta talk about impact.
So, again, if you are interested to discuss seriously these issues and going beyond advocacy and looking exactly on the impact of policies, then we should look at this issue. But it's one thing that I have to correct you, Lisa. It's not true that the UN had a blind eye on those countries that had misused the convention.
Lisa, I assure you, you know, I'm quick. One thing that you rightly point out about the impact. So I've been actually giving drugs like marijuana to people for about 20 years, right? And I have published these studies in the finest journal. So when we talk about researchers, I don't know if it gets any better than what we have up here. Now, impact. When we think about the studies that you cited about marijuana on youth, have you actually read the studies? Because if you read the studies, you wouldn't make those statements. Let's talk about one of the most popular studies with marijuana and the youth. There was a study came out of New Zealand about a year ago. They showed that people, young people who started smoking marijuana before 18, they had a higher likelihood of losing IQ points. So you started smoking marijuana heavily before 16 or 18, you lost some IQ points. They lost about 5 or 6 IQ points over time, by the time they were 38. If you look at that study, it included about 1,500 people. But when you look at the group who lost IQ points, it was 19 people. You're only talking about 19 people, and when you look at the IQ points that they said they so supposedly lost, their IQ remained within the normal range. That means that if we test the people's IQ on the left side of the room with the right side of the room, you'll see a difference. But when you look at their functioning, their IQ remains in the normal range. That difference means nothing for functioning. And people around the world are making a big deal out of that.
No, I'm talking about medical research, not social science research.
That's medical research. That's published. That paper was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. And then if you want to look at brain imaging studies, which I'll be talking about later today, one of the things that people do oftentimes with the brain imaging studies, they'll show differences between two groups on some sort of brain measure. We can do the same thing in this here room. If we measure your brains versus your size, you'll see differences. The question becomes, what does those differences mean? There are all kinds of differences between men and women when you look at their brains, but they mean nothing for functioning. And the researchers never say this. They act as if it means something. But when you test the function of these people, they function the same. So the research, interpretation of the research is the problem. The data themselves are not the problem, it's the interpretation. Lisa.
I just wanted to add a couple of points. First of all, I would like to convene you to challenge the assumptions we all of us made here. So the first assumption is that the international drug control system is a control system. I would say that when it comes to the recreational use of all of these substances that were made illegal for this particular purpose, it's everything but control. It has gave the control to criminal gangs, and it's an underground economy that's one of the huge, like one of the largest commodity markets on earth, that it has created a lot of profits and that always will have working for labor first, you know, like to fulfill all of these positions that are free when we put some gangster in jail or whatever, or someone gets killed. But the importance of that is that governments actually have the choice of changing that and taking drugs back into control for recreational purposes as well, not only for medical or scientific uses. Because the reality is that if you take a pragmatic approach to drugs, a serious one based in evidence, but also based in human rights principles, and also based in developmental principles, you have to take this market under control again, and you have to regulate that. So I will go back to a little bit to these definitions. It's not only about decriminalizing possession for personal use, because the thing is that we created the problem prohibition for recreational use, and now we're trying to fix it, but it's like putting a band-aid on a major, like a major surgery. You're never gonna fix the problem of stigma. You're never gonna fix the problem of incarceration, overcrowded prisons. You're never gonna solve the problem, all the problem of human rights violations associated with the war on drugs. And you're never gonna solve the problem of money laundering, or even all of these associated problems with drug trafficking, if drugs are still illegal for recreational use, and governments keep on giving up on the right to control this particular market. So when we're talking about legalization, for example, which is a word that scares the hell out of most of people, you're only talking about a specific process in which a substance is no longer illegal, becomes legal, and then you start regulating. So, for example, the Uruguay case, it's a law that was, at first, when the President Mujica sent this bill to Congress, it was just one article. The particular law that came out of Congress comes with over 40 articles on how are we going to regulate this thing. But on top of that, there's a reglement, there's secondary laws that touch upon a variety of laws that had to do with agriculture, with security, that had to do with human rights and stuff, that are going to actually regulate the cannabis market for the Uruguayans and like the citizens and the residents in a way that has never been done before for recreational purposes. So it's not about giving up on crime. It's not about giving up on protecting kids from in terms of public health. It's about regulating a market that can have control in terms of access, that can have controls in terms of outlets, that can have control in terms of quality. God only knows what is the quality of the drugs we're consuming if the only one in charge of regulating that quality is the dealer. God only knows, and you all know because you're young and you have been living in I don't know how many countries. The easiest thing to do is to get illegal drugs. It's a lie that they're protecting children from illegal drugs by banning drugs. Prevention is not a synonym of prohibition. You cannot prevent by prohibiting something. It's actually the easiest way of getting children into drugs. You protect children through information. You protect children through education. You protect children through quality controls. You protect children with right services. And most important, with right policies that are youth-friendly. Because they also have told us that in order to protect children, then children should not stockpile drugs. Children should not supposed to go to public health services to get testing, or should not be allowed to, for example, like all of these initiatives, and you have some here in Europe about testing for drugs in recreational settings, in raves or electronic parties and whatnot. This should be something that should be associated with the right of children to full health and the right of young people to health. Now, another thing is, yes, we sort of turn a blind eye on these things because countries are are taking a wrong interpretation of the conventions by increasing the penalties and the criminal sanctions for drug offenses. I was at the CNC this year, the Commission on Narcotic Drugs. It was incredibly heavy. It was impossible to have a statement in government to sign a statement on the death penalty. It didn't happen because there is a very strong lobby among the countries. I'm not blaming the United Nations for this, but among the countries there's a big lobby to actually keep this policy that has been very successful for some countries. But let me tell you something. I come from a country that's on the side of these developing countries. I come from Latin America. And the drug policy that we have currently at the international level is one that has transferred the costs from the countries that are consumers, from the first world countries to the third world countries. We are supposed to control the production, we are supposed to control the transit, and we're also supposed to bear all the costs associated with that policy.
Just a quick point. I just want people to understand that by making drugs illegal, you do prevent, you make it more difficult for people to get drugs. Lisa, getting illegal drugs is not the easiest thing, trust me. We don't want to send that message because, I mean, I go around the world and I try and check markets myself personally. And that's an overstatement. I mean, I don't want to buy into that. I agree with your point in that if we really wanted to protect children, there are some other things we can do. But I don't want anybody to leave here thinking that you can, All right, let's have an experiment. How about you guys go tonight and see if you can get some cocaine on the street? You will find it difficult. It's a difficult thing.
Can I just a couple of things?
I'm afraid we have to move on, but we can definitely come back to some more questions in the Q&A. But I will put a challenge, whether it's easy to get illegal drugs or get a visa to travel. I think that would be interesting.
No, if it is easier to get an antibiotics in Colorado or cannabis.
Great. But let me turn our attention to youth and drug policy, because we are running out of time and I want to make sure we cover the ground. And I want to begin by asking Sophia, you, and then I'm also very curious, and Adeolu, your input on this. What is the impact of the war on drugs on youth, based on your experience working the Corner Project, your experience also having spent time in New York City, and you've gone around and met quite a few interesting people and so on, and also Adeolu, from your experience working with YouthRISE?
For me, I think what I saw a lot when I was working at the Corner Project, and we would go out into the street and talk to people, just community members, give them safer sex kits that had condoms in them and other ways, finger condoms, dental dams, things that can protect you from contracting STIs, HIV, hepatitis C. And you know, we try to have conversations with people, you know, and try to introduce them to the idea of harm reduction. And it was actually quite shocking how little people really knew about what was going on, and you know, especially in terms of the youth and their own health and safety. I mean, the neighborhood that I was working in, I mean, the young kids, they like to party, and that's okay, you know, like they like to go out, they like to take drugs, they like to have fun, but they weren't aware of the risks that they were putting themselves into. For example, if you're sniffing cocaine with a couple of friends and you're sharing a bill or a straw, you can contract hepatitis C like that. It's that easy, and you know, that is a potentially life-changing disease, to a virus to get, to contract. So, you know, I think with the war on drugs and harm reduction and policy, the youth needs to get more involved and more educated, and you know, to then be able to continue on spreading the messages about, you know, safer sex, safer drug use. You know, if you want, whatever you want to put into your body, at the end of the day, it's your choice. It's your body, it's your choice. It's just really about being safe and, you know, making sure that whatever you're doing is done where you feel comfortable and you're in a safe environment. And also as well, working with people that I've been working with, the drug users, they need support from people. They feel right now, a lot of them feel that they're not getting support from anybody. And they've kind of been cast aside. And when I, you know, when I came all the way from Budapest to New York City, they couldn't believe it. They're like, how could somebody, you know, come from so far away to work specifically with us? That's something that they never really experienced before. But you know, I keep telling them, you'd be surprised at actually how many people, especially, I would hope, younger generations really do care. And you know, you guys are all here, so clearly you guys care. So it's important. We take them to trips up to Albany to get them involved, to meet senators, to talk about their stories, you know, to get bills passed and lobbying and stuff like that. So I think if the youth could be more involved, it could, you know, we'd be able to push a lot of things forward a lot more quickly.
Okay, permit me to actually jump on the last comment before this question in terms of accessibility of drugs. Let me put it right. Within the African context, I've actually moved within some countries within the continent, and I will tell you that today drugs are more accessible than ever before. You don't need to struggle to get access to cocaine, heroin on the street, methamphetamine, and for some of us, you know that even in Nigeria, no. Now, oftentimes, most of the African countries are being called transit countries, but now they are turning to be a producer country in terms of, you know, even synthetic drugs. Talking about methamphetamines, about 5 laboratories have been discovered in Nigeria, clamped down. So, and you can be sure that there's so many more that are yet to be discovered. So, in terms of accessibility, drugs are more accessible and cheaper than ever before within our countries. Having said that, looking at, you know, talking about the impact of the war on drugs on young people, I would say it has been enormous in the sense that it has further marginalized the vulnerable group of people within the society. You know, the impact of the, you know, of the war on drugs has made young people to lose so many of their productive years. You can imagine, you know, having young people put in jail, incarcerated for mere drug use. I can give you some instances. I met a guy while during one of our community outreach work. And when I was interacting with him, and he said, look, he just came out of the prison. Well, in the Nigerian government would tell you we don't imprison them, but they put them in detention. And he stayed there for 12 months, for 1 year. And I said, what was your offense? He said he was caught by the police for smoking marijuana. And he was taken to detention, and he spent 12 months. And at that point, before he was arrested, he was working actually as a security personnel in one of the microfinance banks. When he was arrested, he lost his job. So he was in prison for 12 months. And when he came out, he was jobless. And by the time I met him, he was a dealer. He started dealing in drugs because he needed to survive. So I started asking the question, what has the law done? Has it made him better? He was working, he was thrown into prison, then he came out, he became jobless, and now he was a mere smoker before he was arrested. Now he has been released, he's a dealer. So this impact has been enormous. And also if you look at the health challenges, many of the young people who use this drug are driven away from services, health services, because they can go there to access health care. In fact, for drug users, they feel comfortable to say, look, they are living with HIV than to say, look, they are using drugs. Because they feel it's going to be, you know, they will be highly stigmatized. Of course, harm reduction services are non-existent within the region. And young people are day after day getting infected, you know, with HIV and AIDS. You talk about even young people who are women, they are more vulnerable. I've also had interaction with young females who inject drugs, who at the same time are pregnant. Some of them have delivered, given birth, and some of them are living in bunks. And because they are trying to hide away from the law enforcement agencies, so they are driven underground. They are driven even into the ends of criminal gangs. So when the law is trying to say, look, we are trying to protect children, we are trying to protect young people by being, you know, bringing up stiffer penalties against drug use, it's actually causing more harm. Because these people now, services are not available. Where few services are available, they're further driven away from these services. They can't access it because of fear of arrest. And also, they have been, you know, these people, the drug users, have been subject of extortion by, you know, law enforcement agencies. For instance, you know, within our communities, this, you know, is a community, you know, is a society where corruption pervades the society. So when a policeman feels, look, I'm running out low on cash, he knows how to go out to go and get drug users. And say, look, I'm going to arrest you. Then you get them arrested and say, for you to get yourself to get yourself released, you need to get me some money, some cash. So then such a person had to, you know, find a way of getting money. And such individual, even when you don't have the money, you're pushed to the wall, maybe calling one of your friends, look, you need to go and get, you know, to do something. Maybe to go and steal something or just find the money to get me out of here. And so the impact is actually enormous. We've also recorded cases of rape, in which law enforcement agencies, you know, agents goes out after female drug users and to say, look, for you to get yourself released, or if you don't want me to charge you to court, then you have to allow me to have sex with you. And, you know, these are enormous challenges, and most of them engage in unprotected sex. So you talk about exposing these females to infectious diseases like HIV, then also, when you talk about, you know, because of the prohibition regime that we've implemented for a very long time, law enforcement, you know, the healthcare of drug users has been within the domain of law enforcement. And you can imagine what it means if the law enforcement agents are the one providing healthcare to drug users. So it's an issue of torture, it's an issue of criminality.
Let me, we'll come back to law enforcement very quickly. I want to turn it over to Lisa very quick because I'm aware that you've also done work with YouthRISE. And I'm also particularly interested, and I'm sure the audience is as well, with the work you've also done with Contra Delincuencia. If you could say a few words about that.
Thank you. Well, the experience that I have engaging with young people in Mexico is particularly interesting, I wanted to say. First, because we have seen that the drug policies have had a much more harmful impact on the side of security and enforcement and criminalization than they have had in terms of health. So, for example, our health problem in Mexico with drugs is alcohol. is the most consumed drug and is the one that causes the most harm in terms of public health, followed by polyconsumption, so the mixing of one or more than two drugs at the same time. But what we have seen, for example, in Mexico, is that the policy of militarization to fight organized crime, particularly when it comes to narco-traffic cartels, has caused, for example, the decrease in 1 year in the life expectancy of young males. So young males from 18 to 35 now live 1 year less in Mexico because of a homicide epidemic. And this has been caused by a policy that has actually caused this much harm in terms of social related harms. Another thing that has been very interesting is that people come closer to us. I also was founder of the harm reduction and drug policy program of an NGO that's called Escolea, and we work only with young people. They come to us to ask for help and legal assistance sometimes, because after they have been detained and go to prison for drug offenses, they carry a criminal record that stays with them for the rest of their lives. So finding a job then is finding a job later on. Very difficult finding housing and trying to engage again as active members of the community has proven to be very difficult. The other thing is evidently that having access to the right services has proven very problematic in the sense that they need parental authorization, for example, to get to these particular services, even if it comes to services of sexual and reproductive health and rights. If they are under the influence of a substance, or if they are suspected to be drug users, they're denied the services. So this has been particularly important. And in terms of delinquency, what we have seen is that one of the effects that's also a very harmful effect of these policy choices is that these two discourses of criminality and drug use get conflated in the public arena, making all of the drug users potential delinquents or all of the delinquents drug users, which is not the case, at least not in Mexico. But we have governments that are convinced that by tackling drug users as a target population, they will reduce criminality. So they had set, for example, the famous drug courts model, in which if you committed a felony, then but you were under the influence of the substance, you get to a special tribunal, and then the sanction, the threat of going to jail is removed if you actually commit to go to a treatment program, into a rehab program. The problem with that is that the penal sanction gets reactivated if you fail in this particular treatment, and these are normally abstinence-based treatments. So what you end up criminalizing at the end is the use of a certain drug, not only the crime or the felony committed, and then you end up forgiving other felonies. So I will just give you an example. There is a tribunal in Monterrey in Mexico that has most of the persons that have been actually sent to this particular tribunal committed a felony under the influence of alcohol. Most of them are there for alcohol consumption. So when they succeed at completing these rehabilitation programs, what you end up not sanctioning is domestic violence. Most of them were detained in the first place because they were committing domestic violence or violence against a member of their family. So they commit to the tribunal, they succeed at this rehabilitation program, and then what you don't sanction is violence against women or domestic violence. So there's a bunch of stuff that are related to this that I would just like you to think about. It's not easy, because what I wanted to say as well is that any policy choice will have its consequences. So even if we move towards a different regime, we will have to be aware of the potential consequences that that alternative regime will have, particularly, for example, in terms of information, education, public health, etc. But this is not impossible. Change is always possible. And then looking for the most appropriate alternatives is something that we should be very sensitive about. Because evidently, young people are most vulnerable in these things, because in most of our countries are not considered full citizens yet. Still, they bear the consequences as if they were adults.
Thank you very much. I actually want to get Carl into this real quick, because having read your book, Carl, and knowing that you've grown up in one of Miami's toughest neighborhoods, and now from where you've come, where you came from, and now what you're doing is almost, I would say, a different world. Based on your experience, I'd be curious to hear how, first of all, hear a little bit about your experience growing up, and how would you recommend the audience, which is majority youth here, how can they better engage in public policy?
So you talked briefly about my upbringing. My upbringing is, I grew up in the hood, in the projects, favelas, whatever you all call it in your country. And that's important at some level, I guess, in terms of how I see the world. But it really isn't so important to me. I'm a scientist, and the thing that guides my behavior is evidence, real evidence. Like earlier was said that the UN reports are based on evidence and not politics. That's just simply not true. What we do around the world, especially in the United States with drugs, is so political, and it's so dishonest to say that it's not political. It's dishonest in that if we think about what I do, I'm a researcher. Most of my research is supported by the U.S.'s National Institute on Drug Abuse. We are supposed to be scientists, but the focus, our focus, is almost exclusively on the bad things that happens with drugs, 90% or so. But the majority of people who use drugs don't have a problem. So our focus is disproportionately on the negative sort of effects of drugs. That's a political decision, and we pretend that it's objective. It's not. And that guides my position. The evidence always guides my position. And the evidence should guide you all's position. Because when we talk about the impact of the drug policy, the people who are currently being impacted by negatively about our current drug policy are poor people and brown people around the world that we don't care about. Because I assure you, if other people were being impacted negatively by our policies, in the United States at least, and we drive a lot of this crap, in the United States at least, it would change overnight. I assure you. So we are dishonest when we say this is not political. It is so political.
Okay. I want to ask Angela this too, which is a lot of the participants for GDPPC have written policy memos and policy briefs towards the government and giving recommendations. Now, this is part of the competition. Tomorrow, they'll be graduating, going off into the real world. At this point in time, and from your vantage point, working in an international organization, how would you say their work can best inform and advise international organizations, especially folks in power positions which are more experienced than senior policymakers? How can their work influence the work that you're doing?
Oh, okay. Well, I would say the best way of influencing the work, first of all, is to be professional. And what does it mean to be professional? It's true that the drug policy, as we know, is very opinionated. Not only, not an issue of politics, it's an issue of opinions. And so if you are the policymakers of the future, I hope, after this debate, I didn't come here for you to change your ideas. I came here to hope from a young audience that you understand that the issue of drug policy is not as simple as to say that, these poor people go to prison, and then when they go in prison, they rape, they think, everything happens, and so on. Guys, when I go to this debate, I say, that you are the only one who talks about war on drugs. We passed that stage. It was an issue of 10 years ago when indeed some of the countries used the drug policy to make foreign policy. But now we passed that stage. We don't want to hear about war on drugs. It's not a war. The debate at the international level is to understand how can we rebalance the drug policy to put the drug user in the center. And to rebalance where, even in terms of resources, where we have to try not to treat drug users as criminals. We continue to say not to misuse the convention with the death penalty and so on. Read the UN document, read the contribution. You will see all of these kind of things. So let's start debating, leave aside the war. Again, nobody is talking about, beside those that want to, promote certain opinions. So to me, the best way that you can enforce this discussion, get documented, okay? I don't want to tell you what you want to think and what direction you would like to take if today you were one of the policymakers that have to make decision. But I want to tell you just a few things from what it was said here. You know, this mantra and these things that all drug users go to prison and so on, well, show me the data. Show me the evidence. I can tell you that, you know, for this World Drug Report, we really try to say, we really want to understand what happened on the criminal justice for drug users. So we wanted to know for each country, how many people are caught by the police? How many people go to treatment, being forced treatment or whatever? How many go to prison? Well, we could find data for very few countries. For the US, we could not. And if you have that data, please send it to us. I'd be very happy to show it. So again, and if because really for the US, there are data for federal prison, but there are no data for state prison. So we don't know. And I ask all the best researchers on drug policy to tell me this, to give me this answer. We have some data from a few European countries where you will be surprised to see what the countries that you know have been being the champion of some or more liberal. Look at how many people they put in prison from drug use. So the issue of organized crime, yeah, everybody again simply say, oh, we legalize drugs, there is no drugs, then we organize crime will disappear, stop violence. Well, again, it's not as simple as that. You know, the violence in Mexico started because there were less drugs going from Mexico, no more drugs. And then, okay, if we use the same policy response, then I can tell you today, the organized crime in countries like Italy, you know where they make most of the money? Waste management, okay? So do we they legalize any kind of waste management, toxic waste and so on? So we eliminate the violence of organized crime? Is this the answer that we wanted to give as policymakers? That's again, you know, is not as simple as that. Today, I'm asking you, do you think that any kind of medications should be out of the counter? Do you think that everyone should be free to go walk on a shop and say, okay, today I get an antibiotic, tomorrow I get this without prescription? Again, that's a policy choice. Do you think that you can do that? Well, today in Colorado, you cannot get an antibiotic, but you can buy cannabis that if you, and you can get as much quantity of cannabis that you want to get you down.
Hello. Let me just say something. You know, you mentioned the fact that you know, the war on drugs is just opinion of some people. Nobody's talking about that. But I can tell you, every day, I've got a government that speaks about we are winning the war on drugs every now and then. It's still a word that is being used. And I keep asking myself, are we fighting any war? But they keep using, I can show you newspaper captions when, you know, they will boldly say, yeah, we are winning the war on drugs. And I tell you, their implementation strategy is still like we are fighting a war. And that war is a war on drug users. And that's the way it has been. So we need to really focus on this outrightly to say, look, it's good that it's coming, you know, from United Nations to say, look, we're no longer fighting a war. Let it sink down into the government to know that, look, we are actually not fighting war on, you know, fighting a war. It's actually about people. It's actually about people. I agree with you that the issue of drug policy is an hydra-headed thing and it's not as easy as we think, but the fact still remains that the so-called unintended policy, you know, unintended consequences that we've witnessed so far should be enough evidence to make us have a rethink, should make us have a rethink to change our policy strategies and focus. But we don't really see that happening. So
I can answer if you want.
No, we need to move on.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say that no one here is actually advocating for a silver bullet option. Evidently, as I said, every policy option has its impacts. So legal regulation of drugs is evidently not going to solve the organized crime problem, or it's not going to solve the development problem. It's not going to solve all of the public health problems, but it's going to solve the prohibition problem. And that's a lot for many countries like mine. So when we're saying no one's talking about the war on drugs, probably not. But in a country like mine, where effectively violence actually started because there were less drugs, well, yes, there is something that the UN actually called the balloon effect in the World Drug Report of 2008. And that relates exactly of how the violence dynamics played in the Latin American continent. So when they actually were very successful at tackling cocaine availability going out of Colombia, violence increased in Mexico, well, yes. But that's also a consequence of this terrible policy that has its consequences. And so no one can tell me that we surpassed this rhetoric of the war on drugs when in my country we still have, in the last year of the new government, we still have over 20,000 deaths related to this. So we're counting over 120,000 people killed, over 26,000 people disappeared, and we have an increase of 3,000% in the number of suits and complaints against enforcement authorities in Mexico, because it's a massive, it's disproportionate use of the force of the state. So I just want you to think about that. Evidently, all policy choices have their ups and downs. We're not claiming that we're going to solve all of the world's problems, but we can solve some of the unintended consequences of these regimes.
Thank you guys very much. We have limited time, and I'm going to turn our attention to the third part of our discussion on looking at drug policy and development. As you know, Carl, I want to turn back to your memoirs. I found something really interesting that I want to also address, and I may be making a terrible summary here, so forgive me about that. But you said that we tend to associate drug use, let me rephrase it. You said behaviors that we associate with drug use are often not due to the drugs themselves, but the socioeconomic factors like poverty, unemployment, inequality, etc., that poor people tend to have less alternative reinforcers like jobs and stable families. Could you elaborate a little bit more, and also on the kind of human experiments that you had in the labs?
Yeah, so one of the things that Lisa warned us to do early on was not to conflate these issues of like the pharmacological effects of the drug versus something else, and we do this all the time. So it really isn't about drugs. It's about just policies in general. Whenever you have policies, any policy, whether it's your policy to regulate your traffic, the people who pay the price most, the people who will be fined the most, are poor people, no matter what the policy is. That typically is how it works. And drugs just become one of those sorts of things. So now when we think about drugs and what we think of drug effects, we oftentimes look at poor people who we're catching often for these drug violations. And we say that the drugs are responsible for their behavior. Now, one of the things that I did in the book was try to think about some of the behaviors that concerned us in the United States, for particularly as it related to crack cocaine when it appeared in the mid-1980s. A number of things we attributed to crack cocaine, like high unemployment rates, mothers abandoning their children so that grandmothers were raising children. All of these sorts of things were attributed to the effects of crack cocaine. But then when you look at all of the evidence, the highest unemployment rates in the United States were in about 1982, long before crack appeared. And then you look at the sort of grandmothers raising children. That had always occurred in the United States before crack appeared. A number of these things that we attributed to crack was already present in poor communities, but we blamed the drug for it. And one of the things that happens as a result of blaming the drugs, politicians are allowed now to not to focus on the real issues that poor people face, but instead they can say that they're going after the drugs. And you, the population, think, oh, well, they really care, when in fact they don't. They may care at some level, but they certainly don't care about that problem, because that problem oftentimes is due to lack of employment, lack of skills, a wide range of things that happens to people who are shut out. And so as we think about young people moving forward and what you can do to get in this discussion, One of the first things you can do is actually educate yourself and read. That's why I wrote the book, so that you could learn how to think critically. And then you wouldn't have to rely on what we say, because when you look at the evidence objectively, it's really clear. And you know what? It's not that difficult when you look at the evidence carefully and clearly.
So if you want to get your input on this as well, and just elaborate from your experience, are these the people that came to your center and look for help? Are they also people with less alternatives, or?
It really, again, it varies from person to person. I met so many people while I was there, and they all had very different, interesting backgrounds. Some of them, yes, they came from families and situations that put them at a higher risk of being exposed to drug use. A lot of people that I met had parents that were already active drug users. While, for instance, a mother was pregnant with her son or her daughter, so they're already born into that kind of environment. But honestly, a lot of people that I spoke to said that they started taking drugs because they were curious, not because, you know, they're in any sort of situation where they felt like they didn't have any way out and they needed some sort of escape. But just because, you know, they were young, they started drinking beer with their friends, then they started experimenting with pot, you know, and it just continued and it just got out of control. So, I mean, I don't feel that it's definitely a factor when you can't only look at drug use as the only issue. You have to look at a bunch of other things like poverty and where you're growing up and the environment that you live in. But I wouldn't say that that's always, it's not necessarily always the issue. Sometimes it's just curiosity that does it as well.
I didn't answer your question about this. When we think about why people use drugs, Sophie was absolutely correct. People use drugs for a variety of reasons, but the thing that you all must remember is that the vast majority of people who use drugs don't have a problem with drugs. In fact, our last three presidents all used drugs when they were young, and they went on to become president. So we want to make sure that we're clear about this. Now, the thing that concerns us, all of us up here, are the people who actually get in trouble with drugs. And so the question becomes, why do certain people get in trouble with drugs and others do not? Now, there is a variety of reasons. Lack of alternatives, lack of options, and that sort of thing certainly plays a role. But a major sort of factor in terms of why people become drug dependent has to do with co-occurring psychiatric illnesses. So people have things like depression, anxiety, schizophrenia, a wide range of these sort of disorders that are not treated. And sometimes they try to self-medicate. Other times, people become drug addicts because they don't have much experience with responsibility skills. So they don't know how to temper their behavior, not only with drug taking, but in a variety of domains. So as we think about why people become drug addicted, they become addicted for a variety of reasons. And the most important thing, however, for us, particularly people who are trying to understand this, is a careful assessment of why those people are dependent or addicts. That's critical. And we can't throw everybody in the same sort of basket. Because you use heroin doesn't mean that you have a problem with heroin. Most people who use heroin don't have a problem with heroin.
Thank you. We only have about 10 minutes left, and I want to pose a question to our entire panel, and we can go around once and briefly, and please, briefly. One question that came across to the team yesterday was, for you guys, was do you believe that all countries have been appropriately or fairly incorporated into the debate on international drug policy?
Well, no, I don't think so, because every country experiences its own drug phenomenon differently. I just wanted to say I agree. The drug phenomenon is a multidimensional issue. So it has a variety of impacts. In some countries, it's more a matter of the impact of drug use, as in Chile, for example, just subscribing it to the Latin American region, that is the one that I know the most. Or in other countries, it's the violence. In other countries, it's that the lack of opportunities for decent livelihoods of people, so they get involved into the drug trade or the drug production issue. So it varies. Now, every country has the same right and a voice and a vote within the international organizations and the international mechanisms. Yes, but the truth is that we still have some countries that are the leaders in the discourse of how are we supposed to, all of us, pursue these policy choices and find whatever you like, regulate drugs or go like tougher on drugs from the law enforcement perspective. I would say that what we're seeing now, because of the dynamics of the drug trade and because of the dynamics of drug use, there's a lack of participation of many countries, particularly from Central America, particularly from the Caribbean. The Caribbean is one region that has been very key and suffering most of the unintended consequences, but also West Africa.
Well, when you talk about participation, I think all countries participate, of course. You know? They may participate on what they think is relevant and important. And but I wanted to say something that you mentioned in terms also of what matters for countries and the issue with development. Recreational use of drugs, and particularly cannabis, is an issue of rich countries. And is an issue of when the drug debate at international level, most of the so-called, even if, you know, the developing Asia, part of Africa and so on, in relation to this problematic use of hard drugs. So that's why some of the countries have not been involved, I mean, they are not interested in getting into the issue of legalizing cannabis, because cannabis is not the issue. The recreational use of cannabis is not an issue of the biggest countries that we have in the world. So what is the most concern of the countries, the problematic use? And in terms of looking at the impact, it's true that the public, the harm that is most is highest for non-regulated drugs than for regulated drugs. Why is it to ask then the regulation works? Because then, you know, we have about 200,000 people dying from drugs a year against the, you know, 3 or 5 million of people dying for tobacco and alcohol. And what, well, if we want to do impact analysis, what can we say about the impact of the regulating drugs? Yeah.
Okay. Let me say that not our society know that not all, you know, all the countries have fairly participated in this, you know, debate on drug policy, especially looking at the African continent. You look at many countries who see drug policy as a means of maintaining international relationships. So it's actually not a space to be, you know, to be debated in. It's all about we need to, you know, to maintain our relationship with, you know, with the foreign partners. So I will say no. However, it's very, very, you know, the in terms of the impact of this, you know, of drug use and drug trafficking, is enormous. But we've decided in a way to turn a blind eye to it, except we have a strong group of voices, or, you know, strong advocates coming out to say, look, this is an issue we need to talk about. For instance, looking at, you know, the trafficking of drugs, you know, from Latin America to, you know, to West Africa. Look at, you know, an inflow of about $1.2 billion, you know, a year of drug that is even higher than the, you know, the national budget of many of the countries within the region. So this has a grave consequence in terms of the stability of the region, in terms of, you know, security, in terms of health, and not just that the drugs just move away, they also, you know, they are consumers within the region and with antecedent health consequences. So this is actually an issue that needs to be brought to the fore, an issue for, you know, to be debated, an issue to be talked about. Of course, I know in my country there was a time that you can't even talk about, you know, issues of, you know, around drug policy, because it's believed is a restricted domain to law enforcement. And when you begin to talk about it, you are at risk of getting, you know, harassed by, you know, by law enforcement agency to say, oh, maybe you are a trafficker. So I think there's need for everyone, you know, the countries to begin to open up the space to debate this, because I tell you, it's a growing issue, it's an enormous issue that needs to be addressed. And except we begin to speak up, you know, on this issue, a lot of things, arms will be going on, unrecorded, unattained to, and many lives will be lost.
Thank you.
Okay, so again, I look at all these questions from a very like harm reduction grassroots perspective. So when I think about countries and how they're participating, I think of, you know, the places that have, for example, safer injecting sites or harm reduction facilities or certain exchange programs. So there's definitely places in the world, like in Sydney, they have a safer injection facility. And for anybody that doesn't know what that is, it's a place where active drug users can go and take their heroin while being observed by medical professionals to ensure that they're shooting in the correct spot, they're not hitting an artery, they're shooting the right amount, and if for whatever reason they do end up going into an overdose, there's somebody there that will be able to reverse it immediately to save a life. So in terms of looking at it that way, there are definitely countries that could obviously improve the work that they do with drug use, because there's a lot of places in the world that do not have access, or drug users don't have access to clean syringes, to clean cookers, cottons, tourniquets, you know, straws, whatever they need. You know, a place like I was working at, we were really fortunate, and the participants were really fortunate to, you know, have that safe space where they could, you know, not only come in and feel, you know, that they're in a place that was non-judgmental, where they weren't going to be stigmatized, but they are also able to have access to everything, basically everything that they needed except for the actual drugs, and were able to, you know, obtain it and know that they'd be using drugs in a safer way. So again, looking at, you know, different countries, the more places that could have, you know, syringe exchange programs, safer injection facilities, the better it would be for the drug users.
I don't really know whether or not all countries have an equal sort of say-so. I don't think that drugs impact each country equally. And so all countries, perhaps they don't need to have as much say-so. But what I do know is that the United States has an uneven or unbalanced sort of influence on much of the drug policies around the world. And one of the things that we're trying to change that in the United States. In the United States, one of the things that the current administration said was, when they took office in 2009, was that they were not going to have a war on drugs. They said that was not what they wanted to do. And they were quite sophisticated in their language. But language means nothing. I'm a psychologist. I'm a behaviorist. It's how you behave. And we are still behaving. We're still using drugs as a tool to further marginalize groups. So we're still arresting people for drugs in the United States at high rates, despite the fact that we don't have a war on drugs. At least we say we don't have a war on drugs, but we still have a substantial number of people locked up for drugs or arrested for drugs.
Thank you very much. One thing I can tell you about my experience in drug policy is I wasn't lying. We can talk for days. But listen, that's all the time we have for now, I'm afraid. We'll take a 15-minute break, and when we come back, we'll open up to a Q&A session with the audience. I want to say thank you again to our panelists for a fascinating talk. And before we take off, as a token of our appreciation for your time and effort, some of our GDPPC participants would like to present to you flowers and say thank you very much.
Oh, wow.
For the entire group.
Oh.
So thank you.